Dear listener, a note of warning from the producers of this audiobook. The original publication of The Art of Dramatic Writing was completed in 1942, and this chapter contains dialogue language that may be racially insensitive to some listening. When listening, please remember it is only being presented in its original writing form to maintain the integrity and the historical context of the play's author in mind and is not meant to hurt or insult anyone. Thank you for understanding. Conflict. 1. Origin of action. The blowing of the wind is action, even if it's only a breeze. And rain is action, even to its name. The verb and the noun are one. Our ancestor, the caveman, killed that he might eat. That was certainly action. The walking of a man is action, the flight of a bird, the burning of a house, the reading of a book. Every manifestation of life is action. Can we, then, treat action as an independent phenomenon? Well, let's look at wind. What we call wind is the mass contraction and expansion of the invisible ocean of air which surrounds us. Cold and heat create this movement called wind. It's the result of varied contributing factors which make action possible. Wind, inactive alone, is impossible. Rain is the product of the sun and other factors. Without them, there would be no rain. The caveman killed. Killing is an action. But behind it, there's a man who lives under conditions which force him to kill for food, self-defense, or glory. Killing, although an action, is only the result of important factors. There is no action under the sun which is the origin and the result in one. Everything results from something else. Action cannot come of itself. Let us look further for the origin of action. 1. Motion, we know, is equivalent to action. Where does motion come from? We are told that motion is matter and matter energy, but since energy is generally recognized as motion, we're back where we started. Let's take a concrete example. The protozoon. This one-celled creature is active. It performs life activities, and they are obviously the outgrowth of something specific, the protozoon. Is the action of the protozoon inherent or acquired? We find that the chemical composition of the animal includes oxygen, hydrogen, phosphorus, iron, calcium. These are all complex elements, each highly active in its composition. It seems, then, that the protozoon inherited action with its other characteristics from its multiple parents. We'd best halt our search right here before it entangles us in the solar system. We cannot find action in a pure, isolated form, although it's always present as the result of other conditions. It's safe to say we conclude that action is not more important than the contributing factors which give rise to it. 2. Cause and effect. In this chapter, we shall divide conflict into four major divisions. The first will be static, the second jumping, the third slowly rising, and the fourth foreshadowing. We shall examine these different conflicts to see why one is static and remains static regardless of what you do, why the second jumps, defying reality and common sense, why the third, the slowly rising, grows naturally without obvious effort from the playwright, and why, without foreshadowing conflict, no play can exist. But first, let us trace a conflict and see how it comes into being. Assume that you are a gentle, inoffensive young man. You've never hurt anyone, nor have you any intention of breaking laws in the future. You're single, and you meet a girl who pleases you at a party to which you had not meant to go. You like her smile, the tone of her voice, her dress, her tastes, and yours coincide. In short, this seems to be the beginning of a deep-rooted love. With great trepidation, you invite her to see a show with you. She accepts. There's nothing wrong in this, nothing unusual, and yet it may be a turning point in your life. At home, you look over your wardrobe, which consists of the single suit you wear on all gala occasions. Under your critical eyes, it sheds all the requirements you think necessary for such a suit. For one thing, you decide it's out of style. For another, it looks cheap and shabby. She's not blind, she's sure to notice. You decide that you must have a new suit, but how? There's no money. What you earn, you hand over to your mother, who keeps house for you and your two small sisters. Your father is dead, and your salary must take care of all the family expenses, the shoes for the children, the doctor bills for your mother. The rent is due. No, you cannot buy a suit. For the first time, you feel old. You remember that you're over 25, that it will be years before either of your sisters is old enough to work. What's the use of planning, of living, of taking your girl to the theater? Nothing can come of it anyway. So you drop her. This step makes you cross at home, listless at business. You may brood over your condition. You'll be despondent. You cannot stop thinking of the girl, of what she must think of you, of whether you dare call her up, of the impossibility of your ever seeing her again. You're negligent at the office, and before you realize it, you're out of a job. This does not improve your temper. You go on a frantic job hunt and find nothing. You apply for relief and get it after a harrowing, long, drawn-out, shameful experience. You feel as useless as a squeezed lemon. After you get on relief, you discover that you receive too little to sustain life well, but just enough to keep you from dying of hunger. As you see, this conflict and almost all conflict can be traced to the environment, the social conditions of the individual. Now, the question is, of what material you are made? How determined are you? How much stamina have you? What amount of suffering can you endure? What was your hope for the future? How far-seeing are you? Have you imagination? Have you the ability to plan a long-range program for yourself? Are you physically able to carry out any program you may plan? If you are sufficiently aroused, you'll make a decision, and this decision will set in motion forces to thwart itself, foreshadowing a counteraction which will oppose you. You may never be aware of the process, but the playwright must be. You never know, when you invited this girl to the theater, that you had started a long chain of events which would culminate in your desperate decision to take action now. If you're strong enough, conflict is born, the result of a long evolutionary process which might have begun with an everyday occurrence, an invitation perhaps. If the young man makes a decision but lacks the strength to carry it through, or if he's a coward, the play will be static, moving very slowly and then on an even plane. The author would do best to leave such a character alone. He's not yet ripe enough to carry on a protracted conflict. If the dramatist has vision, he may be able to visualize this character at the psychological moment, the point of attack, when the weakling or coward is not only able to face a battle, but can meet his adversary more than halfway. This will be discussed further under Point of Attack. A jumping conflict would occur if the young man decided upon seeing the shabbiness of his suit to rob a bank or hold up a passerby. It's illogical that an inoffensive boy would arrive at such a conclusion so rapidly. There would have to be more crushing events, each more urgent and painful than the one before, to force him to take this fatal step. It's possible that at a moment of frustration and despair, a man will do the unexpected in real life, but never in the theater. There we wish to see the natural sequence, the step-by-step development of a character. We want to see how the cloak of decency, high moral standards, is torn away from a character shred by shred by the forces emanating from him and from his surroundings. Every rising conflict should be foreshadowed first by the determined forces lined up against each other. We shall make this clearer as we go along, but there's one thing we wish to emphasize here. All the conflicts within the big major conflict will be crystallized in the premise of the play. The small conflicts, which we call transition, lead the character from one state of mind to another until he's compelled to make a decision, see transition. Through these transitions or small conflicts, the character will grow in a slow, even tempo. In another chapter, we've discussed the complexity of the word happiness. Take away a small fraction of any part and you see how the whole structure of happiness loses its unity and undergoes a radical change, which in the process of reshifting may turn happiness into unhappiness. This law governs infinitesimal cells, humans, and the solar system. Dr. Miloslav Demeric read a paper on heredity before the annual meeting of the American Association for the Advancement of Science in Richmond, Virginia on December 30, 1938. He wrote, "The balance within a gene system is so sensitive that the absence of even one gene out of a total of several thousand may upset it to such an extent that this system is not able to function and the organism does not survive." Moreover, numerous cases of interaction between genes are on record where a change in one gene affects the functioning of another seemingly unrelated gene. Considering all the evidence, it seems apparent that the activity of a gene is determined by three internal factors. 1. The chemical constitution of the gene itself. 2. The genetic constitution of the gene system in which it acts. And 3. By the position of the gene in the gene system. These three internal factors, together with the external factors forming the environment, determine the phenotype, totality of inheritable characteristics, of the organism. A gene, therefore, should be considered as a unit part of a well-organized system and a chromosome, a higher type in that organization. In that sense, genes as individual units with fixed properties do not exist, but their existence as component units of a larger system with properties partially determined by that system cannot be denied. Just as a gene is a unit, but part of a well-organized society of genes, a human being is a unit, part of a well-organized society of human beings. Whatever change comes over the society will affect him. Whatever happens to him will affect the society. You can find conflict all around you. Watch the members of your family, your friends, your relatives, your acquaintances, your business associates, and see if you can discover one of the following traits: affection, abusiveness, arrogance, avarice, accuracy, awkwardness, brazenness, bragging, craftiness, confusion, cunning, conceit, contemptuousness, cleverness, clumsiness, curiosity, cowardice, cruelty, dignity, dishonesty, dissipation, envy, eagerness, egotism, extravagance, fickleness, fidelity, frugality, gaiety, garrulity, gallantry, generosity, honesty, hesitance, hysteria, heedlessness, ill temper, idealism, impulsiveness, indolence, impotence, impudence, kindness, loyalty, lucidity, morbidity, maliciousness, mysticism, modesty, obstinacy, prudishness, placidity, patience, pretentiousness, passion, restlessness, submission, sarcasm, simplicity, skepticism, savagery, solemnity, suspicion, stoicism, secretiveness, sensitivity, snobbery, treachery, tenderness, untidiness, versatility, vindictiveness, vulgarity, zealousness. Any of these and thousands of other traits can be the soil from which a conflict springs. Let a skeptic oppose a militant believer, and you have a conflict. Cold and heat create conflict, thunder and lightning. Bring opposites face to face, and conflict is inevitable. Let each of these adjectives represent a man and imagine the possible conflicts when they meet. Frugal, spendthrift. Moral, immoral. Dirty, immaculate. Optimistic, pessimistic. Gentle, ruthless. Faithful, fickle. Clever, stupid. Calm, violent. Cheerful, morbid. Healthy, hypochondriac. Humorous, humorless. Sensitive, insensitive. Dainty, vulgar. Naive, worldly. Brave, cowardly. When our caveman ancestor went after food, he fought with a tangible enemy, a huge beast which meant food, a conflict. He threw his life into the balance, and the fight was to the death. This was rising conflict. Conflict, crisis, conclusion. A football game represents conflict. The teams are evenly matched. Two strong groups face each other. See orchestration. But since victory is the goal, the fight will be bitter and hard won. Boxing is conflict. All competitive sports are conflict. A saloon brawl is conflict. A fight for supremacy among men or nations is conflict. Every manifestation of life from birth to death is conflict. There are more complex forms of conflict, but they all arise on this simple basis, attack and counterattack. We see real rising conflict when the antagonists are evenly matched. There is no thrill in watching a strong, skillful man fighting a sickly, awkward one. When two people are evenly matched, whether in the prize ring or on the stage, each is forced to utilize all that is in him. Each will reveal how much he knows about generalship, how his mind works in an emergency, what kind of defense he's capable of, how strong he really is, whether he has any reserve to marshal as a defense when he's in danger. Attack, counterattack, conflict. If we try to isolate and examine conflict as an independent phenomenon, we're in danger of being led up a blind alley. There is nothing in existence which is out of touch with its surroundings or the social order in which it exists. Nothing lives for its own sake. Everything is supplementary to every other thing. The germ of conflict can be traced in anything, anywhere. Not everyone knows the answer when he's asked to name his ambition in life, yet he has one, no matter how humble, perhaps for that very day, week, or month. And out of that small, seemingly inconsequential ambition, a rising conflict may grow. The conflict may become increasingly serious, reach a crisis, then come to a climax, and the individual is forced to make a decision which will alter his life considerably. Nature has an elaborate system of distributing the seeds of various plants. If every single seed were given a chance to develop in its year, mankind would be choked out of existence, and the plants as well. Every human being has an ambition of some sort, depending on the character of the individual. If 100 people have similar ambitions, the odds are that only one of them will have the perfect combination of circumstances in himself and in the world about him, which will permit him to achieve his goal. We're thus brought back to character, to the reason why one will persist and another will not. There is no doubt that conflict grows out of character. The intensity of the conflict will be determined by the strength of will of the three-dimensional individual who is the protagonist. A seed may fall at any given point, but it will not necessarily germinate, and ambition may be found anywhere, but whether or not it germinates will depend upon the physical, sociological, and psychological condition of the person in whom it exists. If ambition were to flourish with the same intensity in every man, that too would spell mankind's doom. On the surface, a healthy conflict consists of two forces in opposition. At bottom, each of these forces is the product of many complicated circumstances in a chronological sequence, creating tension so terrific that it must culminate in an explosion. Let us witness another example of how conflict comes into being. Brass Ankle by Dr. DeBose Hayward offers intimate insight into how conflict is born. Larry, the husband, startled. Ruth and I aren't going to keep that kid. Doctor, you surely don't think we're going to keep a nigger in the family. Dr. Wainwright, that, of course, is your affair, yours and Ruth's. After all, he is your son. Larry, my son? A nigger? Larry is the leading citizen of a small town, and he's fighting to segregate the Negro from the white. He believes that even a drop of Negro blood makes a man unfit to associate with whites, and now his wife, White, has given birth to a Negro. It is a personal tragedy. If the town gets wind of it, he will become a laughingstock for life. This is an aggravated conflict. Larry will be forced to make a decision, admit the child is his own, or deny his fatherhood. But at this moment, we're not interested in what will happen. We wish to trace the origin of the conflict. We want to know how conflicts come into being. The author says, Larry's about 30 years of age, tall, straight, and good-looking, with fair hair and high color. His quick, nervous gestures indicate a high-strung and emotional nature. Before his marriage, he was lazy, we dare say. He was pampered by women and perhaps had many affairs. But there was one girl, Ruth, John Chaldon's granddaughter, a dark, compelling beauty, a lady different from the other women in the village. She never paid any attention to Larry, but he wooed her persistently, mended his ways, and at last she gave in and married him. Is there any clue thus far which would indicate a conflict to come? There are many, but they would mean nothing if the locale happened to be New York. Don't forget the vital importance of the location. We shall see why later. Once more, Larry's physical makeup, good-looking. He's spoiled. He has a way with women. Otherwise, he would have never married Ruth, and the tragedy would not have occurred. Now, the environment, the particular time of the event. It is two generations after the Civil War. Liberated Negroes live in the town, as do mulattoes and part Negroes who pass as whites. There are more than a few nice, respectable families, apparently white, who are known to the village doctor to be Negro. Having brought most of them into the world, he alone knows who is who. He knows that Ruth has Negro blood in her, although she has passed for white. As a matter of fact, she's thought herself white. She has an 8-year-old daughter who's apparently white. The second child is one of those rare throwbacks. That Ruth is good-looking and a lady is also an important factor in the coming conflict. Larry, I always swore I'd marry a lady. I ain't got no kick coming. And in another place, Larry, and I owe it all to you. I never had any ambition until I married you. Larry is now the proprietor of a successful store thanks to Ruth's influence. Their physical qualities attracted them to each other. The environment made Larry what he was, lazy, arrogant, spoiled. It also made Ruth dignified, soft-spoken. To him, she was an ideal. To her, he was a child. Her dignity appealed to him since he lacked dignity. His devil-may-care manner appealed to her since she lacked ease. His great love assured her that she could make a man of him. The environment again. A small town, few young people. If there had been more girls, Larry might not have married Ruth, but there weren't many girls, and he's supremely happy with his wife. He's more and more ambitious, and the townsfolk want him to be the first mayor of the growing community. Agnes, a neighbor. Lee, her husband, says, "You've got the case on the Jackson children all ready for the superintendent of education. I've had a lot to do with that, you know. If I hadn't kept after him, he never would have stirred himself. I say if he expects me to give him children, he's got to see that they can go to school without having to sit by people we all know's got nigger blood." Larry, in a tired voice, "Yes, Agnes, we know you had a lot to do with it." This dialogue indicates the town's anti-Negro sentiment, which forces Larry to take an anti-Negro stand, too. It also shows that he is the leader, and we know he wishes to remain the leader for the love of Ruth. So he runs and barks with the pack, aggravating, building, strengthening the coming conflict, which will crush him. So it seems that conflict does spring from character after all, and that if we wish to know the structure of conflict, we must first know character. But since character is influenced by environment, we must know that too. It might seem that conflict springs spontaneously from one single cause, but this is not true. A complexity of many reasons makes one solitary conflict. 3. Static. Characters who cannot make a decision in a play are responsible for static conflict, or rather, let us blame the dramatist who chooses the characters. You cannot expect a rising conflict from a man who wants nothing or doesn't know what he wants. Static means not moving, not exerting force of any kind. Since we intend to go into a detailed analysis of what makes dramatic action static, we must point out right here that even the most static conflict has movement of some kind. Nothing in nature is absolutely static. An inanimate object is full of movement which the naked eye cannot see. A dead scene in a play also contains movement, but so slow that it seems to be standing still. No dialogue, even the cleverest, can move a play if it does not further the conflict. Only conflict can generate more conflict, and the first conflict comes from a conscious will striving to achieve a goal which was determined by the premise of the play. A play can have only one major premise, but each character has his own premise which clashes with the others. Currents and undercurrents will cross and recross, but all of them must further the lifeline, the main premise of the play. If, for instance, a woman perceives that her life is sterile and cries her heart out, pacing her room, but does nothing about it, she's a static character. The dramatist may put the most haunting lines in her mouth, but she remains impotent and static. Grief is not enough to create conflict. We need a will which can consciously do something about the problem. Here's a good example of static conflict. He, do you love me? She, oh, I don't know. He, can't you make up your mind? She, I will. He, when? She, oh, soon. He, how soon? She, oh, I don't know. He, may I help? She, that wouldn't be fair, would it? He, everything is fair in love, especially if I can convince you that I'm the one man you want. She, how would you do that? He, first of all, I would kiss you. She, oh, but I won't let you until we are engaged. He, if you don't let me kiss you, how on earth are you going to find out whether you love me or not? Conflict. She, if I like your company. He, do you like my company? She, oh, I don't know, yet. He, that settles the argument. She, how? He, you said. She, later on I might learn to like your company, though. He, how long will that take? She, how am I to know? We can go on, and still there will be no substantial change in these characters. There is conflict, all right, but it's static. They remain on the same level. We can attribute this staticness to bad orchestration. Both are the same type. There's no deep conviction in either of them. Even the man who pursues the woman lacks the drive, the determination of a deep-rooted conviction that this is the only woman he wants for his mate. They can go on like this for months. They might drift apart, or the man might force a decision at the end. The Lord knows when. As they stand right now, there are no happy choices for a dramatic composition. Without attack, counterattack, there can be no rising conflict. She started from the pole of uncertainty, and at the end, she is still uncertain. He started from the pole of hope, and at the end, he is still in the same state of mind. If a character starts from virtuousness and goes to villainy, let us see what intervening steps she has to take. 1. Virtuous, chaste, pure. 2. Thwarted, frustrated in her virtue. 3. Incorrect, faulty, unbecoming behavior. 4. Improper, she becomes indecorous, almost indecent. 5. Disorderly, unmanageable. 6. Immoral, licentious. 7. Villainous, depraved, wretched. If a character stops at the first or second step and lingers there too long before taking the next step, the play will become static. Such staticness usually occurs when the play lacks the driving force, which is the premise. Here's an interesting static play, Idiot's Delight by Robert E. Sherwood. Although the play's moral is highly recommendable and the author is deservedly a well-known playwright, it's a classic example of how not to write a play. See synopsis on page 285. The premise of this play is, do armament manufacturers stir up trouble in war? The author's answer is yes. The premise is unfortunate. It's superficial. The play has direction, but the moment the author chooses a segregated minority group as the archenemy of peace, he negates the truth. Can we say that only the sun is responsible for rain? Of course not. There can be no rain without the oceans and other factors. No armament maker can stir up trouble if there is economic stability and contentment in the world. Armament manufacturing is the outgrowth of militarism, insufficient domestic and foreign markets, unemployment, and the like. Although Mr. Sherwood speaks about the people in the postscript of the printed version of his play, he sadly neglected them in Idiot's Delight. There are no people in his play, no people who really matter. We see Mr. Weber, the sinister armament manufacturer, who says he wouldn't sell armaments if there were no buyers. This is true. The crux of the point is, why do they buy armaments? Mr. Sherwood has nothing to say about it. Since the conception of his premise is superficial, his characters necessarily become colored photographs. His two main characters are Harry and Irene. Harry moves from callousness to sincerity and fearlessness of death. Irene starts from loose morals and ends up on the same lofty heights as Harry. If there are 8 steps between these two poles, then they started at the first, stayed on it for 2.5 acts, leaped over the intervening 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th steps as if they had never existed, and started to move again from the 7th to the 8th step during the last part of the play. Characters wander in and out with no particular motivation. They enter, introduce themselves, and leave because the author wishes to introduce someone else. They re-enter for some artificial reason, tell what they think and how they feel, and wander out again so that the next batch may come on. One thing on which we hope our critics will agree with us is that a play should have conflict. Idiot's Delight has it only in rare spots. Characters, instead of engaging in conflict, tell us about themselves, which is contrary to all standards of drama. What a pity that Harry, jovial and good-natured, and Irene, with a colored background, were not used more advantageously. Here are a few typical excerpts. We're in the cocktail lounge of the Hotel Mont Gabriel. A war is expected at any moment. The borders have been closed and the guests cannot leave. We turn to page 6 and read, Don. It's lovely there, too. Cherry, but I hear it has become too crowded there now. My wife and I hoped it would be quieter here. Don, well, at the moment, it is rather quiet here. No conflict. Now we turn to page 32. People are still wandering in and out aimlessly. Quillery enters, sits down. Five officers come in and talk in Italian. Harry comes in and talks to the doctor about nothing in particular. The doctor leaves and Harry talks to Quillery. After a moment or so, the latter, without apparent cause, addresses Harry as comrade. The author says, when Quillery comes in, an extreme radical socialist, but still French. What the audience sees is that he's mad, except at a very few rational moments. Why should he be mad? Because apparently he's a radical socialist, and extreme radical socialists are all mad. Later, he is killed for taunting the fascists, but now he and Harry talk of pigs, cigarettes, and war. It's all empty talk. And then he says, this socialist, this is not 1914, remember. Since then, some new voices have been heard, loud voices. I need mention only one of them, Lenin, Nikolai Lenin. Since this extreme radical socialist is a madman and is treated as such by his fellow characters, the audience may believe they're hearing of another extreme radical socialist, synonym madman. Then, Quillery talks of revolution, futile idealism to Harry, who doesn't know what it's all about. But that just shows you how crazy these extreme radical socialists are. Now we're on to page 44. The cast is still coming in and going out. The doctor bewails the bad fortune that keeps him here. They drink. They talk. A war may break out, but there is still no sign of even static conflict. There is no sign of a character, with the exception of a certain madman to whom we have referred. We turn to page 66, sure that we shall have some action this far along in the play. Weber, will you have a drink, Irene? Irene, no thank you. Weber, will you, Captain Lo Cicero? Captain, thank you. Brandy and soda, Dumpsty. Dumpsty, si, senor. Bebe, yells. Edna, we're going to have a drink. Edna comes in. Weber, for me, Cinzano. Dumpsty, oui, monsieur. He goes into the bar. Doctor, it is all incredible. Mary, nevertheless, doctor, I remain an optimist. He looks at Irene. Let doubt prevail. Throughout this night, with dawn, will come again the light of truth. He turns to Shirley. Come on, honey, let's dance. They dance. Curtain. We rub our eyes, but this remains the end of the first act. Should any young playwright dare to submit a play such as this to any manager, he would risk being thrown out on his ear. The audience must share Harry's optimism if it's to overcome such a dose of hopelessness. Sherwood must have seen or read Journey's End, in which soldiers in the frontline trenches go to pieces in the nerve-wracking wait before they go over the top. The people in Idiot's Delight are also waiting for war, but there's a difference. In Journey's End, we have characters, flesh-and-blood people, whom we know. They're striving to keep up their courage. We feel, we know, the big push may come any minute, and they have no choice but to face it and die. In Idiot's Delight, the characters are not in immediate danger. There's no doubt that Sherwood had the best of intentions when he wrote the play, but good intentions are not enough. The greatest dramatic moment of Idiot's Delight is in the second act. It's worthwhile to glance at it. Quillery heard from a mechanic who may have been wrong that the Italians have bombarded Paris. He goes berserk. He shouts, Quillery, I say, damn you, assassins! Major and soldiers, jump up. Assassins! Harry, now listen, pal. Shirley, Harry, don't get yourself mixed up in this. Quillery, you see, we stand together. France, England, America, allies. Harry, shut up, France. It's okay, Captain. We can handle this. Quillery, they don't dare fight against the power of England and France. The free democracies against the fascist tyranny. Harry, now for God's sake, stop fluctuating. Quillery, England and France are fighting for the hopes of mankind. Harry, a minute ago, England was a butcher in a dress suit. Now we're allies. Quillery, we stand together. We stand together forever. Turns to officers. The author makes this pitiful figure turn toward the Italian officers. He's afraid they will not take offense, in which case the great dramatic scene will collapse. So the poor fool turns toward the officers. Quillery, I say damn you. Damn the villains that sent you on this errand of death. Captain, if you don't close your mouth, Frenchman, we shall be forced to arrest you. The first step toward conflict. Of course, it isn't quite fair to fight a demented man, but it's better than nothing. Harry, it's all right, Captain. Mr. Quillery is for peace. He's going back to France to stop the war. Quillery to Harry. You're not authorized to speak for me. I'm competent to say what I feel, and what I say is, down with fascism! Abbasso fascistno! After this, of course, they shoot him. The others go on dancing and pretend they're not very much impressed. But they can't fool us. At one point, Irene delivers a splendid speech to Achille, but before that point and after it, nothing. Another less obvious example of static conflict can be found in Noel Coward's Design for Living. Gilda has alternated between two lovers until her marriage to a friend of her lover's. All three men are friends. The two lovers come back to claim Gilda. Her husband is naturally outraged. The four are together now at the end of the third act. Gilda, blandly, now then. Leo, now then indeed. Gilda, what's going to happen? Otto, social poise again. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Gilda, you know you both look figures of fun in pajamas. Ernest, the husband, I don't believe I've ever been so acutely irritated in my whole life. Leo, it is annoying for you, Ernest. I do see that. I am so sorry. Otto, yes, we're both sorry. Ernest, I think your arrogance is insufferable. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. I am very, very angry. Gilda, for heaven's sake, tell them to go. Gilda, they wouldn't. Not if I told them until I was black in the face. Leo, quite right. Otto, not without you, we wouldn't. Gilda, smiling, oh, that's very sweet of you both. There is no visible development in character, hence the conflict is static. If a character, for any reason, loses its reality, it becomes incapable of creating rising conflict. If we wish to portray a bore, it's not necessary to bore the audience, nor is it necessary to be superficial to show a superficial personality. We must know what motivates a character, even if he does not know himself. The author must not write in a vacuum to show characters who live in one. No sophistry will explain away this fact. Gilda, blandly, now then. Now then means what is going to happen now, and no more than that. There's nothing in it of provocation, of attack leading to counterattack. Even for the shallow Gilda, it is too ineffectual, and it gets the right answer. Now then, indeed. If Gilda's remark had imperceptible movement, Leo's response had none at all. It not only fails to take up the tiny challenge she offered, it leaves it as it was, no movement to be seen. The next line is sarcastic, but the three oh dears are not only not a challenge, but an admission to the speaker's impotence to remedy the situation. If you doubt this, look at the next line. You both look figures of fun in those pajamas. Apparently, Otto's sarcasm passed unnoticed. Gilda has not been touched, and the play refuses to move. The very least the author could have done at this point was to show another facet of Gilda's character. We might have seen the motivation behind Gilda's love life, her flippancy. But we see nothing but a superfluous comment to be expected from characters who are simply mannequins through whom the author speaks. Ernest, I don't believe I've ever been so acutely irritated in my whole life. Anyone who says such a line is harmless. He can whine, but he cannot add or detract from the sum of the play. His exclamation does not aggravate the situation. There is no threat, no action. What is a weak character? One who, for any reason, cannot make a decision. Leo, it is annoying for you, Ernest. I do see that. I am sorry. There is something in this line, a trace of heartlessness. Leo doesn't give a damn about Ernest, but the conflict stays where it was. Then Otto steps in and assures Ernest that he too is sorry. If this is funny at all, it's because such an attitude in life would be brutal and unfeeling. The character who can employ such humor and still be heroic does not exist and cannot create conflict. Ernest's next speech is revealing. The antagonist admits that he cannot put up any sort of a fight, that he must appeal to the goal, Gilda, to fight his battle for him. Gilda, Otto, and Leo want what they want, and there is no one even to try to stop them. This may be funny in a two-line gag, but it isn't the conflict necessary for a play. If you reread the whole quotation, you'll see that at the last line, the play is almost in the same position as when it started. The movement is negligible, particularly when you remember that the act goes on like this for several pages. In Brass Ankle by DeBose Hayward, almost the whole first act is taken up with exposition, but the second and third acts make up for the bad first one. In Design for Living, there is cause for conflict in the initial situation, but it never materializes because of the superficiality of the characters. The result is a static conflict. 4. Jumping. One of the chief dangers in any jumping conflict is that the author believes the conflict is rising smoothly. He resents any critic who insists that the conflict jumps. What are the danger signals which an author can look for? How can he tell when he's going in the wrong direction? Here are a few pointers. No honest man will become a thief overnight. No thief will become honest in the same period of time. No sane woman will leave her husband on the spur of the moment without previous motivation. No burglar contemplates a robbery and carries it out at the same time. No violent physical act was ever carried out without mental preparation. No shipwreck has ever occurred without a sound reason. Some essential part of the ship may be missing. The captain may be overworked or inexperienced or ill. Even when a ship collides with an iceberg, human negligence is involved. Read Good Hope by Hydermans and see how a ship thus goes under and human tragedy reaches a new height. If you want to avoid jumping or static conflicts, you might as well know beforehand what road your characters have to travel. Here are a few examples. They might go from drunkenness to sobriety, sobriety to drunkenness, timidity to brazenness, brazenness to timidity, simplicity to pretentiousness, pretentiousness to simplicity, fidelity to infidelity, and so on. If you know your character has to travel from one pole to another, you're in an advantageous position to see that he or she grows at a steady rate. You're not fumbling around. Instead, your characters have a destination, and they fight every inch of the way to reach it. If your character starts from fidelity and with a gargantuan leap arrives at infidelity, omitting the intervening steps, it'll be a jumping conflict, and your play will suffer. Here is a jumping conflict. He: do you love me? She: oh, I don't know. He: don't be a dumbbell. Make up your mind, will you? She: smart guy, huh? He: not so smart if I can fall for a dame like you. She: I'll smack your face in a minute. She walks away. He, in this instance, started from fondness and arrived at sneering without any transition at all. She started from uncertainty and leaped to anger. The man's character was false at the start, false because if he loved her, he could not ask for her love and say in the same breath that she's a dumbbell. If he thought her dumb in the first place, he wouldn't want her love. Both are of the same type again, impetuous, excitable. Transition in such characters moves with lightning speed. Before you know it, the scene was over. Yes, you can prolong it, but since they're moving with leaps and bounds, they'll be in each other's hair in no time. Lilium in Ferenc Molnar's play is the same type as he in this scene, but Lilium's counterpart is exactly the opposite. Julie is subservient, patient, and loving. Badly orchestrated characters usually create static or jumping conflict, although even well-orchestrated characters can jump, and frequently do if the proper transition is missing. If you wish to create jumping conflict, you have only to force the characters into action which is alien to them. Make them act without thinking, and you'll be successful in your own way, but unsuccessful with your play. If, for instance, you have as your premise a dishonored man can redeem himself through self-sacrifice, the starting point will be a dishonored man. The goal, the same man honored, cleansed, perhaps glorified. Between these two poles lies a space, empty as yet. How he is going to fill this space is up to the character. If the author chooses characters who believe in and are willing to fight for the premise, he's on the right road. The next step will be to study them as thoroughly as possible. This study will show a double check if they're really capable of doing what the premise expects of them. It's not enough if the dishonored man saves an old woman from fire, a la Hollywood, and is redeemed instantaneously. There must be a logical chain of events leading up to the sacrifice. Between winter and summer come autumn and spring. Between honor and dishonor, there are steps which lead from one to the other. Every step must be taken. When Nora, in a doll's house, wants to leave Helmer and her children, she lets us know why. More than that, we're convinced that this is the only step she could have taken. In life, she might have been tight-lipped, might never have said a word, just banged the door after her. If she were to do that on the stage, it would be a jumping conflict. We should not understand her, although her motives might be of the best. We must be completely in the know, and in jumping conflict, our knowledge is only superficial. Real characters must be given a chance to reveal themselves, and we must be given a chance to observe the significant changes which take place in them. We propose to strip the last part of the third act in A Doll's House, leaving the essentials but still rendering it ineffectual. This is the grand finale of the play. Helmer has just told Nora that he would not permit her to bring up the children, but the bell rings and a letter arrives containing a note and the forged bond. Helmer cries out that he is saved. Nora? And I? Helmer, you too, of course. We're both saved, both you and I. I have forgiven you, Nora. Nora, thank you for your forgiveness. She goes out. Helmer, no, don't go. Looks in. What are you doing in there?